flashback from 2011 interview with Jeremy Seifert about his fantastic GMO film project.
With the time on the doomsday clock quickly approaching the hour, it's time to join Patrick Strider and Richard Swander at Everyman Radio.
We're doing a documentary on food.
Okay.
What people eat. I'm wondering if you eat GMOs.
I don't even know what that is. Give me one sec.
Hey girls, how you doing? I got Hannah tattoo right over there.
What is GMOs? What is that?
Never heard of it.
Don't even know what a GMO is.
GMOs? What is this?
Is it good?
I'm not sure what GMOs are.
What is that, cereal?
I don't know what that is.
What's a GMO?
I don't know.
I was only five when my dad told me I died.
As a matter of fact, if you're talking about like good marijuana, organic grown oatmeal cookies, then yes, I do.
What is GMO?
You never know here what we eat.
That's bad business. See, now you're gonna have me really want to look more into what I be eating, man.
With the time on the doomsday clock quickly approaching the hour, it's time to join Patrick Strider and Richard Swander at Everyman Radio.
Hello, I say good day, sir.
Good day, Patrick.
Good day, Richard.
How are you?
Oh, sweltering in this heat.
Yes, it's hot here too.
Yeah. You've got to make it last before the ice age, mate. Enjoy the day.
Yes, that's right.
There you go. All right. So how's it going? What have you been up to? What have you been up to, lad?
I've been writing, actually.
Ah, interesting. About what?
Well, trying to write some comedy about GMOs, but it's actually very difficult because they're not very funny.
Okay. GMO is not a very funny thing, though, is it?
No, it's not.
We got a great show this evening, haven't we?
Oh, yeah, we have, yeah.
Yeah.
Really good.
Yeah, well, I'm, as I said, I can't wait to run home and listen to it. So, people are not stupid. We can tell them in advance that, you know. Actually, at the moment, I'm in Denmark, but during the week in the process, and by the time they hear this, you will have had your interview with
Jeremy Steifer,
and we're going to edit it, and it's going to be all put together and that, so, you know, we can let them know the reality of how to get a podcast together. So, who've you been writing to? So, you've been writing scripts for your stand-up comedy?
Yes. So, it started off with some GMO references, but it's kind of descended into nothing about GMO at all.
But is it funny?
I've no idea of telling yet.
Okay, but so you've got it all sorted. You're going to go to a pub.
Well, no, I haven't even found one yet.
Okay, well you can just. Go on.
I mean, well, because it's the Edinburgh Festival at the moment, so anyone who's anyone, and all the comedians who run nights are up north.
Up north, lad. Right.
Yeah.
That's
my excuse anyway.
All right. Well, you're always looking for one, wasn't you?
Yes, and this is a good one.
Everybody's in Edinburgh.
Yeah.
Sulu goes to Edinburgh every year, or he used to. You know the Sulu from Star Trek?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, I can't think of his name in real life. But, he usually takes a trip up to the Edinburgh Festival. He always has something on.
Oh, right.
Yeah, I was surprised to hear about that as well. But, that's what he does. He goes to the Edinburgh Festival each year and puts on a little performance of something or other. Yeah,
fancy it?
Yeah. I've never been there. Have you been?
No, I haven't.
No. Never mind. I keep on meaning to. I think I can get a flight from here to Edinburgh. But I've never bothered. I've been to Glasgow, like. I got someone threw a bottle at me in Glasgow.
Yeah, I'm not surprised. It was me, actually.
Was it you? Yeah, I was just walking down the road with a friend of mine in Glasgow, and we were walking next to me. It smash, you know, in the night time, and I just kind of looked around. There was a guy looking at us, and he could have been the only person who threw the bottle, as if butter wouldn't melt in his mouth. It's like, wow, what a crazy place. But anyway, yeah, so GMOs.
Yes, genetically modified organisms.
Yeah.
I actually had to look at what the O stood for.
Well, good job you did, because I asked you that question.
Yes. Because I'm so used to saying GMOs and hearing about GMOs, and I'm just wondering, what is the O exactly?
Could have been oddities, couldn't it? genetically modified oddities.
Yeah, that's nearer the truth.
Yeah. So what interesting stuff have you come up with then?
Well, there's a couple of interviews. Sorry, not interviews. Documentaries that I've seen. Okay. I've actually seen them quite a while ago. There's The World According to Monsanto, and which is quite a renowned one. That's about it's really quite unbelievable. The unbloody believable. How farmers in the US who will be wanting to just grow organic, and they may get pollen from a farmer who's growing GM foods, which will then contaminate his crop. And you'd think, logically, if your crops get contaminated by somebody else, then you should be able to sue them and get compensation. But what actually happened is Monsanto, who's the owner of this variety of crop, will sue the farmer for having varieties of their seed on his land, even though it's come from the air.
Yeah. So it's shocking. I knew that, actually. I knew that.
It is.
Yeah. That is. Go on.
Well, and other things, how Monsanto puts pressure on the farmers to, if they want to, you know, contest any of this, then they'll just put a long strung out legal battle that the farmers can ill afford. So it often ends in out of court settlements, or the farmers just giving in and then having to adopt the GM foods, whether they like it or not. The GM seeds, yes.
Yeah, I heard about policies in South America. I can't remember which country, probably Mexico, actually. Where they were actually purposefully, I mean, I haven't got an answer back this up at the moment, but you know, I'm sure a search will show it. Where they actually went around actually, you know, throwing their crops in farmers' fields, you know.
Yeah, can believe it.
Yeah, you know, sly little. I want to swear, Richard, but I won't. Not really, I do, but I won't. This is Monsanto. My particular first introduction to GMs was back in the 1970s when I was a young whippersnapper, and I went to an off license and bought a can of Coke, and it was a diet one. You know, it was a hot day, and I took a sip, and I got this aftertaste of, and it tasted like, to me at that age, potatoes, and so it went directly in the bin, even though it was a hot day, and I've never touched this stuff since. It's amazing. The body just said, no, thank you. Don't like that.
And they found that the genes that were inserted into soybeans transferred into the DNA of the bacteria living inside us, and certain varieties of genetically modified corn are engineered to produce an insecticide living inside us.
I'm looking at the food that's in the grocery store. They say it's safe, everybody eat more. On second thought, I don't really know if it's made with those GMOs. So I'm looking for the non-GMO label. Before I bring it home, I put it on a table. I wanna know if it's verified, so I don't harm myself with genetically modified.
They don't want you to know.
Poison they grow.
Profits they show.
From those GMOs.
Seeds that they sow.
Gonna hurt us, we know.
Told them to go.
Say GMO, no. Hey, look. I don't wanna eat poison. I don't want gene mutations at my dinner reservations. It's a food abomination. What they're doing to this fast food nation. They take artificial gene combinations, inject it in seed variations, so they can grow their frankenfood imitations while the side effects cause medical patients. Keep the profits alive while they're spraying all the food with name brand herbicides. And all the while they're spreading their lies. Monsanto destroy a farmer's lives. And the FDA just keeps it all going, saying it's safe, even though they all know it's just poison stealing away your life. And that's why
what you eat, but genetically modified. They don't want you to know. They don't want you to know. Poison they grow. Profits they show. GMO? No. Seeds that they sow. Gonna hurt us, we know. Told them to go. Say GMO, no.
FDA scientists said GMOs might create allergies, toxins, new diseases, and nutritional problems.
Corporate myth. If you don't believe me, listen to Jeffrey Smith. He's the man with the plan, gonna do what he can to help us all get those GMOs banned. But we need you to lend a hand, take a stand against this food scam. It's a mission for the health condition worldwide, cause we don't wanna live genetically modified.
No testing necessary. No
living inside us. As you know what's in it. Don't believe the propaganda, the press will spin it. Affects everybody, we all up in it. Stand up to Monsanto, tell him, oh no you didn't. Reject Franken foods in the store. Demand honest labels so we can be informed. We have a natural right to know what we buying. Just say no to GMOs before our farms start dying. Just say no to GMOs. These corporate crooks are lying. Just say no to GMOs. This time we're not complying. Just say no to GMOs. Just not buying. Just say no to GMO.
No testing necessary. No insecticide.
Just say no to GMO.
No testing necessary. No insecticide.
Just say no to GMO.
Yeah, so I threw the Diet Pepsi Cola in the bin, and then that was it. I never touched the stuff ever again. Disgusting stuff, really. And the body just says no, thank you. And that was it, as a teenager.
Yeah. Talking about bins, Jeremy Stifert, whom I'm interviewing, his first film was all about all of the waste that goes into bins in the States. So, you know, all of the food produce. And you have people, actually just normal people, not people living on the streets, actually going to dumpsters and collecting food that's perfectly good to eat, but just being thrown away. So his first film's all about, you know, the massive waste of food by all these big companies. And then that's led him on. Well, I'll find out how he's interested in, after the earthquake in Haiti, Monsanto delivered food aid, but they delivered, I think, 415 tons of genetically modified crops for the Haitians, who, quite amazingly, just burnt it in the streets because they were very adverse to GM foods poisoning their growing supply.
Excellent.
So it's going to, yeah, quite interesting to find out what the film, the documentary he's raising money for at the moment, how that's going to turn out and what he's been doing.
Okay.
So looking forward to that.
Yeah, me too.
Good to see some activism.
I just love activism. People who are still awake. People who still want to kick ass. Absolutely. You know, these Monsanto blokes and all these big corporations, they don't sleep, man. They don't sleep. 24 hours a day of evil, you know. And we just don't have the resources to be 24-hour people of defending our own liberties and rights and health, you know.
Yeah. It's true. It's like, when we're looking at Big Pharma, these big companies like Monsanto and Dow Chemicals, they have a slush fund to pay legal fees. They'll introduce a new product. So Monsanto's checkered history, they manufactured Agent Orange, which was dropped all over Vietnam, Southeast Asia, by the US Army. And because they kind of they've managed to get indemnity, so they refuse to pay any compensation. Okay. But they have legal funds to actually pay for these things when they turn up. So they start off denying it for many years, and then eventually it might come up, and they, you know, happily settle out of court just so it doesn't blow up in the world's press.
Yeah. Won't work in Haiti, though, will it? If they burn the crops, they won't settle out of court, will they? They sound like a nice, resilient bunch of people.
No, yeah, sounds fascinating. Imagine, you know, the hell they've been through. Mm-hmm. They're given, you know, some free food, and then they burn it. That's quite incredible.
It's arguable whether it's food, isn't it, really?
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah, Yeah, yeah. So I've been having a little because you know this is the GMO thing was is your baby, man. It's your baby. You
know? My baby.
It's your baby. You've done all the research again on the GMO. But I was looking, strangely enough, in today's Telegraph of all places, GM food toxins found in the blood of 93% of unborn babies.
Yes, I saw that. That's in America.
Yeah, but it says because of the soy and stuff like that, it's actually, and because the soy goes into British farm animals, it's also obviously gets into the human chain. And thus it's actually in us Brits as well.
Does it say that?
Yes, I think it kind of does say that down the bottom there, yeah.
Because there are very different laws. In the US, they've managed to get away from labelling. So the food manufacturers, if it contains GMO products, they don't have to label it, whereas in Europe they do have to. But the key difference is with food animal feed, it doesn't have to be labelled, from what I understand.
Yeah, it's like laundering money.
So we don't know what we're eating. It's difficult to find out whether it is GM-free if the animals, the products of animals that have gone into it.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, you need, if you're going to have a law to protect people from this GM stuff, this poison, because it is poison, Why they get rid of the beginning process is beyond me. You know, you have to be there right at the beginning. If it's GM food going into the cattle, then that's where you stop it. And that's where you have to stop it. You can't have a law that once it goes into the cattle. It's like the World Health Organization and the radiation thing, isn't it? Once it's into the system of an animal, you know, it's anyone, it's up in the air, and, you know, it doesn't really matter. And then it's pretend it isn't there.
Yeah, and there's lots of studies that have been kind of suppressed or ignored that actually do show that when these GM foods are fed to mice and rats and other rodents, then they do suffer genetic malformations in their offspring, and they have high levels of kidney disease, and most of them die, in fact, in the lab.
Yeah, deformities in human beings as well has been shown from from the soy crop. People who live near the farms where the soy crop, the GM soy crop, is being sprayed, and etc. There's been high levels of deformity in childbirths as well.
Yeah, so it's not very funny at all.
No, you can't do a stand-up comedy routine like that, can you?
Just one announcement. Someone dropped some Rizzler outside. Anyone? Any takers? I'll just gotta put it over there. All right, cool. Next up, we have a very fine, upstanding gentleman who got in contact with me just today and said, I would like to come to your open mic and do some stuff. Anyway, I'm going to get off stage. I'm going to hand it over to him. A very upstanding stand-up known as Richard Swander, everyone.
Thanks. Hello, Bath.
Hey!
Anyone from Mexico?
Arriba, arriba! Estupendo!
No, there is. Friend of mine. Anyone from Croatia?
Ooh.
Come on down.
Are you covering all the bases to make sure?
Okay. I've done a lot of travelling. I'm a traveller. I'd say I'm a traveller. And I don't know why I came back to England, really, but I have. But the rest of the world isn't much different. It's just some lovely country that's just ruined by a small group of people who have all the money and just f*** it up for the rest of us.
You can always close the pub if you want.
But one very good thing, Britain, always a good cup of tea. Very difficult to find anywhere else. So I was at university in America, in Ohio, about 10 years ago, maybe a bit longer, and it's just a crazy place. Anyone been to America?
Yes.
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it?
Yes.
I went. I met some guys, and I went down to spring break in Panama City. Spring break is like where all the students hang out. in Easter. And I met these guys and we went down and stopped off by their mum's house and they just showed me their guns. And I just had quite a good time just firing lots of big guns, shotguns, assault rifles. And just the terrifying thing was that their mum had more guns than all of them. And we walked down, no, so we didn't walk, we drove. We drove down to Panama City in Florida. And it was just a bizarre place for sort of entertainment. But I went to the world's largest nightclub in America. Everything's the world's largest. This was the world's largest outdoor nightclub called Spinnaker's. And on stage were a band singing, no, 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 no. There's no lyrics. And I was just gutted. And I was just, I forget the name of them, but I decided to throw my empty beer cans at them. And it didn't go down very well. But I thought it did. This bloke came up to me and said, hey man, that was awesome. Did you just throw beer cans at them? And I was like, yeah. And he said, I work here. I'm security. You're out of here. And before I could do anything, my friends, my new friends, they stepped in front of him and said, hey, he's British. It's cool, man. And I was allowed to stay. And yeah, I was just gutted, really. I'd rather be thrown out. So, yeah, in Vietnam, I just keep getting flashbacks. It's comedy in Vietnam revolves around the tonal language. So you'll say, well, for the expats living out there, it revolves around the fact that the currency is called dong. For example, if I get my dong out,
oh, wait,
okay. It's so 200 dong there, Vietnamese dong, I'll put that way. As you can imagine, you know, it's a laugh every single day playing with money. But for the Vietnamese, the comedy revolves around the tonal language. So I'll say ma, and that means mother. If I say ma, that means horse. And you say it six different ways, it means six different things. So I kept quiet about the fact that I like riding horses. And, yeah, the thing about Vietnam, I had a great time. I went up to, went sightseeing to look at the demilitarized zone, the DMZ. Inappropriate called sightseeing because there's nothing really to see there apart from the effects of napalm and Agent Orange presents from Monsanto that were given to the Vietnamese. But we went sightseeing there and took an internal flight, and this is the really good thing about being British abroad. You can kind of get away with anything. And so my friend, he had an oversized bag he was trying to take onto the cabin, and the security guard stopped him from getting on the plane. So I went up to him, up to the security guard and said, oh, it's okay, he's British, he's a diplomat, it's fine. And so I just picked it up and just walked on. And the security guard was just so confused. It just, fair enough, he didn't know. And yeah, it doesn't work at Heathrow. So don't try that. And I'm very concerned about my health. And I like reading a lot about things that are good for me. I just find it very confusing because I read these things and I just forget them. And I wanted to know why, and I found an article. I can't remember it, but I printed it off. And it says, the Google effect. Search engine harms our memory. From the journal Science, published by the American Association for the Advancement of Science, also known as ARS, we no longer do we have to make costly efforts to find the things we want. We can Google the old classmate. Gosh, I can't read it. Google the old classmate, find articles online, and look up the crappy band that we've forgotten the name of on the internet. It's actually original actor. I just made it up there. Too Unlimited was the band, if you weren't sure. Can you read that?
The internet has become a primary form of external or transactive memory where information is stored collectively outside ourselves.
Thank you. Yeah, so it's stored collectively outside of ourselves. So it's great. So I can read all these articles about, for example, GMO foods. I don't know what I'm eating anymore because GM seeds are in the food supply, fed to animals. I don't know if I'm eating it. I'll read all these articles. It scares me shitless. And fortunately, I can just leave it collectively outside of myself and just leave it on the internet, whatever these articles. So as well as reading, I think Monsanto, we're all screwed, Monsanto suck or something like that. I can just leave it on the internet and carry on with my life. In fact, there's a few I've got, so I've just printed those out. We're all screwed, Monsanto suck. That was one of them. Yeah, so you get the gist. I can actually read all these things, that all the stuff that's killing us, the Monsanto's latest present of biotechnology engineered food in our food system, and I can just shut my computer, just forget all about it, and grab my nice cup of tea, which is now organic cup of tea, and Motai Ba, yo! 1, 2, 3, yo, cheers, in Vietnamese. Thank you very much.
Yeah. It's a Swan Day, boy. That's wicked. I would love more stand-up comics to actually come along to these open mics. The type like Richard Swan Day.
First you told us only through you could we know God, and if we dared to question, he wouldn't spare the rod. For you we worked the soil, for you we dug the moors, for you we shed our blood and fought so many pointless wars. And now you try to tell us there's nothing we can do. You say the world around us belongs fairly to the few, but about 6 billion people no doubt will agree this world is our home. Not your property, it's the commons, our right of birth. And you who would enclose the land all around the earth, our future is your downfall when we cut this ball and chain. You who'd sacrifice the public good for your private gain. With our sweat we built the railroads, built cities on these shores. But because you own the money, you see that it's all yours. We laid the phone lines and the pipelines, and then right before our eyes, you see these things are taxes paid for. You now will privatize. Privatize the hospitals. Privatize the schools. Privatize the prisons for all those who break your rules. And preparing for the day when all the wells run dry, you say you own the very rain that falls down from the sky. But it's the commons, our right of birth. And you who'd own the water all around the earth, our future is your downfall when they cut this ball and chain. You who'd sacrifice the public good for your private gain. You claim to own the harvest with your Terminator seeds. You claim to own the genomes of every animal that breeds. You claim to own our culture and the music that we play. And with each song that we download to your coffers we must pay. You'd even own my name, and you'd say it's for the best. Maybe you'll let us on your radio if our songs can pass your test. You own country, you own Western, you say you've given us a choice. You may own the airwaves, but you'll never own my voice. It's the commons, our right of birth. And you who'd own the music all around the earth, our future is your downfall when you cut this ball and chain. You who'd sacrifice the public good for your private gain, it's the commons, our right of birth. And you who would own everything all around the earth, our future is your downfall when you cut this ball and chain. You who'd sacrifice the public good for your private gain.
Oh, hi, is that Jeremy?
Yeah, this is Jeremy.
Yeah, hi, this is Richard Swander from Everyman Radio.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm good, thanks. How are you?
I'm doing great. That took a little bit of doing to connect, finally.
Yeah, I'm calling you on your mobile, I believe. Is that right?
Yeah, this is a cell phone. It's the only phone I have, actually.
Ah, right. No, that's fine. Is your Skype working, or are you out and about?
Yeah, you know, I just got back. I was out and about, and I forgot to, like, turn it on or whatever. Hold on.
That's all right.
Signing in.
Did you get your car fixed?
Actually, yeah, we ended up retiring it. There's a program they give you $1,000 to give up the clunker.
Oh, right, yeah, cash for clunkers. I heard about that.
Exactly. Okay, I see you. I open Skype. I see Richard. So you want to try that way?
Yeah, sure, yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah, I'll ring off. Yeah, bye.
Skype. Okay.
Hello?
Hello.
There you are.
That's better, isn't it?
And cheaper.
Yes. No, it's great, isn't it? Good old
Skype. It's so much clearer.
Yeah, I know, it's really strange, isn't it? But, yeah.
It's amazing.
Can't believe you're in California.
Yeah, man.
It's like 6,000 miles away.
And it's only 4:30 in the afternoon.
Yeah, it's a bit later here.
Are you at 12:30?
That's right, yeah. So just after midnight. On a very hot, sweaty English summer day, a very rare one. What's it like where you are?
Oh, you know, L.A. is mid-70s, really nice, cool, pleasant.
Really?
Yeah, it's actually a really nice day. I mean, it gets into the 90s sometimes here in the summer, but it's nice.
Oh, that sounds very nice. You're in Pasadena.
We used to be. We moved to Highland Park, which is just about 10 minutes from Pasadena, closer to downtown LA.
Oh, okay. I don't know it. I have been there, actually, many years ago.
Oh, really? Which part of LA?
Santa Monica Boulevard.
Oh, yeah.
After the song, stayed in the youth hostel there. A very funny time. We're very young. And, on a tour of the States when I was at university. So, you know, four friends of mine in a Dodge van driving around in a road trip. It was cool.
Oh, man. That sounds great. I just did that as an adult with my family, jammed into a Volkswagen Eurovan across the entire country. And that wasn't as...
I can imagine.
It was insane.
You didn't have 8 cases of Keystone Ice in the back.
No, I had like one beer to night, you know. Yeah.
No, it sounds good. It's great talking to you. And so very interested. We're doing a podcast on genetically modified organisms and GM foods. And we were looking at other videos. And I became very interested in looking at if there were some current movies on GMO foods. And I came across yours, the work that you're doing. So, yeah, please tell us a bit more about yourself and what your current project is. Because, you know, it's very, very interesting.
Yeah, well, this will be my second film. My first film was called Dive, Living Off America's Waste. And it's about dumpster diving and food waste. And that just came out on DVD July 19th, and it was really from that film plunged me into the whole kind of world of food, so to speak. I guess this wakefulness regarding our food. Most of us are sort of zombies or in a slumber about what we eat and what's in our food, where it comes from. We just don't think about it. It's like, unless we think about how good it tastes or where we can get more of the fix, because it's like a drug or something.
Very true, yeah.
Yeah, so I'd never thought about food waste until I started dumpster diving.
did that, so.
Yeah, for about 4 years. I still do it casually now, but not like the back in the day when it was, you know, 70-80% of what we ate was once trash.
Wow.
But yeah, spinning off that film, I planted a little garden with my son Finn, and just was thinking about food a lot more than I had ever thought about food. And actually, I worked as an assistant on a film in Haiti right before the earthquake, and spent a lot of time in the slums in and around Port-au-Prince, and it was shortly after I was there that the earthquake happened, and so it had a deep impact on me.
Yeah,
and,
of course, yeah.
And then I saw this tiny little article online, I believe it was through the New York Times, talking about these rural Haitian farmers burning seeds that were donated to Haiti from Monsanto after the earthquake. And I just, I couldn't believe that, because I'd experienced the hunger there, the poverty there, and couldn't believe that farmers were burning seeds until I looked into it more and saw what was behind that Trojan horse of a gift. And it really inspired me that 10,000 plus rural farmers marched in the streets and said, "We will burn these seeds if you give them to us." And, you know, looking at the United States.
Yeah, I was just thinking that.
You know, 80% of our processed foods have genetically modified food in them. Almost all of our meat, all of our dairy that isn't organic has genetically modified corn or soy behind it. You know, any and everything that's got oil or fried in oil is genetically modified canola or cotton seed oil. And so, you know, you look around here and nobody's marching in the street and everybody's just eating this stuff and nobody even knows what the hell it is.
Yeah, I saw that in the Sizzler movie you've put together, sort of like the promo film.
Exactly.
It starts hilarious. That guy, I don't know where you got him from, the guy with the megaphone right at the beginning, he's hilarious.
Yeah, that guy is, yeah, he's amazing. I looked at that footage and thought, okay, now I know how to do the sizzle reel.
Yeah.
I'm going to bookend it with this guy. And he's just rattling off at the end, you know, he's like, "Hey, isn't that what the FDA is?"
Yeah.
And he's really, you know, wasn't familiar with genetically modified food or what's happening in the swinging door between these companies and the FDA and EPA. And yet, you know, he hit the nail on the head and said, "Isn't that what the FDA is supposed to be doing? Aren't they supposed to be watching this and looking out for us and protecting us?"
I think y'all need to stop giving people shit that they don't even know what it is. You need to figure it out before you start serving it. Isn't that what the FDA is for?
But the exact opposite is true. They're in bed with these giant companies, and it's a racket. They're making money and they're controlling food from the seed to the plate.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I was just going to say, where we've looked at the Brzezinski, the movie. I don't know if you've seen that, but it's a very similar relationship. The FDA basically working with the big pharmaceutical companies and, you know, all working together as a little clique and putting pressure on Congress, who are part of it as well. So it's interesting. There's a very similar sort of relationship that you say.
Yeah, and it's frightening. I mean, how intimate that relationship is and how many different parts of the government have been infiltrated. And I mean, I guess anybody knows this to a certain degree, that money has now taken over our democracy, and you know, with lobbyists growing by the thousands every year, and many of them former Congress members or people who were closely affiliated with the government are now, you know, lobbying for these companies and have all the ins, and it's insanity. But I think, you know, this issue goes kind of touches on so many issues, because to me, GMO represents all that has gone wrong with farming and agriculture, the death of small farms, industrial ag, heavy petrochemicals, all these things. But then it also represents this whole poisoning of the government. And then it also represents the sort of numb mindedness of most of us who don't even know about them, and how can that be such a horrific disconnect from what we eat? And it also stretches out into all of the environmental catastrophes that, you know, surround them, because GMOs are modified to be dumped with glyphosate, you know, Roundup Ready soy, and so that's the soil, the water, the air. So this GMO represents so much, and not to mention the patenting of life, and loss of food sovereignty, food culture, consumer right to know. I mean, it's huge. It touches on so many issues.
Yeah, I see. Yeah, is that there's a nice little clip of, is that your son Finn in the sizzler?
Yeah, that's my little boy.
Oh, that's sweet. He's collecting seeds, and then it's juxtaposed nicely with, your narration, isn't it, about that similar message? The whole, you know, humanity's, how it, you know, all depends on these seeds, the seeds of life, basically.
What do these rural Haitian farmers and so many countries around the world know that we don't? Is it too late for us to make a change?
Each plant will make a lot of seeds. That's how simple it is. It's like every time you just plant one seed, it like grows into a plant and it produces like thousands of seeds. It's crazy. I haven't got all the stuff in the seeds in my book yet. If I do, then I'll have lots of seeds, right?
Why are you saving all these seeds?
Just because I want all the seeds in the world.
Yeah, and I really, for me, my son is one way for me to get at some sort of hopefulness in a very messed up situation, and that, you know, we can't fall into despair. There is a way forward. But, you know, you can't look at these great things and you know, the hope of a child or the wonder of a child without really going past the dragon or into the darkness. Mm-hmm. And there is a lot of that. And, you know, we don't want to fall into sentimentality and just skip to the good stuff. The sizzle reel is, you know, based on footage from going down to Haiti and then, you know, some footage shot in and around LA. And just this summer, I've embarked on the main shooting for the film, which will continue on into the fall. And that's what we're trying to raise money to make all that happen.
Yeah, I was just going to ask about that. So, yeah, I saw the Kickstarter program that you're trying to raise money for, and how's it going? I haven't checked today, but it seemed to be approaching the target you're after.
Yeah, I think it's getting close. It's probably about $1,500 away from reaching our goal of $25,000, which is really exciting.
Oh, it is, yeah.
But it's also a little bit depressing because the film's budget is, you know, far beyond the Kickstarter goal, but that's just to hopefully get things going and interest more donors and investors in the film.
Yeah, and build momentum. So it's a good point. So it doesn't stop there. You don't, you know, raise the $25,000 and then that's it. Happy days, make the film. It's, you know, just the start of it, really, isn't it?
Exactly. And we're trying to do the film right and, you know, get people involved who are talented and can bring something to the project. And it's, you know, the scope of the film is huge. And I think there are creative solutions, you know, to keep the budget down. And you know, I think that's where creativity really shines, when you're limited in your resources. But we need a lot more money so we can actually hire an editor, so we can continue filming. I have plans to go to Svalbard, Norway, where Kerry Fowler has set up this enormous seed bank for basically a backup for all the seeds of the world, because there's been so much loss of biodiversity in the last 100 years. It's insane, through just lack of funds, and so seed banks rot out and they don't keep up with their collections, or through war, seed banks have actually, you know, been destroyed. So this seed bank in Norway, it's like, you know, instead of some vault for gold or something else that's completely valueless in and of itself, but we've deemed it valuable, this is actually, you know, a vault for seeds, which are the most valuable, precious, priceless thing on the planet.
Yeah, I remember reading about that a couple of years ago. It's right up in the northern hemisphere, isn't it? Very
exactly.
And I can't remember the article, but it was implying that Monsanto and also the Gates Foundation were involved in the financial backing of that. I don't know if you know that to be the case.
That's made it a bit controversial, especially for some, you know, heirloom seed banks and others. But I mean, they were basically, it's really in connection with the Norwegian government, and there have been, some of the backers have been, Gates Foundation, Monsanto, but from everything that I've read about that, and, you know, the way that the Svalbard Seed Bank is set up, that does not give them any rights to it, any access to it. It doesn't compromise the integrity of the seed bank in any way. So from Kerry Fowler's perspective, you know, it's a millions dollar project, and he's not going to turn away people who want to help make it happen, even if it's, you know, the devil giving you money to, you know, save the life of a child or something, I guess. You know, I don't know. I haven't talked to him personally about that process and how he feels about it.
It'd be interesting. Very interesting to find out what you find out there.
Yeah.
It's a very interesting project. I suppose, from what you say, Monsanto might just be slapping a, you know, we're doing a good thing label on there to help with their marketing, because they need all the help they can get.
I'm sure that was one of their chief reasons for doing that, because somebody just showed me an advertisement today. I don't have a TV, so I never see these ads, but there's some ad basically about corn syrup, high fructose corn syrup, and you know, it's like this beautifully shot thing, and there's these two moms, and one mom is pouring this Kool-Aid, and the other mom says, oh, does that have high fructose corn syrup? And the other one says, yeah, of course. Is there a problem with that? Oh, no, yeah, there is, because it's bad, right? She says, really? Really? It comes from corn, and it's natural, and it's da-da-da-da. And basically, they, like, I don't know who's behind the ad, I mean, Monsanto or who, but it has to be. They're trying to rebrand high fructose corn syrup as a good thing.
Nasty.
It's amazing.
Yeah, as you're saying, yes, it's just crazy, isn't it? Just how they think they do get away with it, because the people who watch these adverts, they just go, okay, it's cool now. I'm gonna spray everything with this.
That's about how it works, yeah.
It's amazing.
It is truly amazing.
And has it changed your eating habits, the research you've been doing, or have you, you mentioned that you've always been kind of conscious about food, but have you found anything really shocking that has changed your habits? Or?
Yeah, I think... you know, the more I've become aware of it, I've felt like I'm growing more and more paranoid, because you can't escape it. I mean, you can, but it's really difficult. And especially on the road, you know, with the family, it's almost impossible to avoid eating some kind of genetically modified food. But my habits have changed, but I don't think radically enough, and I think it's just kind of baby steps as I go deeper into this making of the film, which is for me the learning process. Then they'll change my eating habits even more.
Is there anything on the menu that's not genetically modified? Yeah, I'm in search of food that's not genetically modified. It's kind of a quest I'm on.
How long do you think it'll take to get the film out?
I thought you were going to say, how long will...
Do you think
change your eating habits all the
time. It's ongoing, isn't it?
Yeah. The goal, well, it really, the timing of the film is intimately connected to how much money we can raise, because that allows me to hire an editor instead of doing all the editing myself. But if I'm also, you know, directing and producing and doing writing and traveling and then editing, you know, everything goes more slowly, the less money. So the goal was to try to have a rough cut finished in December, but I wouldn't hold my breath.
And so how can our listeners find out more about the work that you're doing and dig into their pockets and help you?
I think the easiest way is go to gmofilm.com, and, you know, right when you go to that page, you can watch the sizzle reel, which is the 6-minute piece kind of showing what the film will be like to a certain degree. And then there's a Kickstarter link on that page. And the Kickstarter campaign has about 10 days left. So that's an easy way to get on there and give anything from $1 to $5,000. And we have, you know, for $50, you can get a signed copy of Dive. It's the last film I did on food waste and dumpster diving. And there's other little prizes on there. So, I mean, that's something immediate. If any of your listeners are extremely wealthy or well-connected, they can go to the same website, and there's a contact email on there. I think it's just info@gmofilm.com. And they can contact us and, you know, explain why and how they're going to give us $100,000. And we'd be happy to receive that.
Of course. Well, I can't promise that. But it's a great sizzler film. I've nicked the word sizzler for the little promo videos that we do for our shows. And
okay.
I quite liked Mumford and Sons, the cave in there.
Yeah, maybe they'll listen to your show and watch the sizzle reel and get excited about how amazing their song is underneath this Haitian woman dancing on a hilltop, and, you know, make it happen.
Well, I don't know them, but they do sound like the type of guys who really would, you know, support something like this.
Yeah, I think they would. I hope they will. And because, yeah, I'd love to use that song in the actual film.
Now, I was just going to say, no, it's just been fantastic talking to you. Is there anything else you'd like to add about the work you've done, or
let's see,
or your plans for the future?
Yeah, no. It's been great talking to you too. I'm really it's been exciting to see how many people care about this, and the people who do care about this care about it passionately. And, you know, we haven't even made the film yet. We're still, you know, we have 80% of the filming to still go out and do, and yet so many people are excited about the film and want to help and want to support it. And I think, I mean, we are going to need all the support and help and love we can get to make this film and make it really great. So, if anybody is listening in or watches the sizzle reel and has a particular skill, graphic design, or whatever they want to contribute, or just thoughts or ideas, please send them our way.
I was going to ask that, actually. I do know that many of our listeners are of that ilk, graphic designers, animators, that type of thing, that we've worked with as well. So that's a possibility, certainly.
Yeah, that would be fantastic, because I have many ideas for the film itself, for, you know, some graphic design and some animation, other ways to kind of tell the story of GMOs and the scope of this global hijacking of food. And then also just for the website up right now is just a temporary website that we just had to throw up there so we could have something. But we're planning on a much larger, more interactive site. So anyway, there's lots of ways, I think, for people to be involved if they're really, really amazing.
Yeah, with you, yeah. Of course, yeah. You want the best, yeah.
So. Of course, yeah. I think this topic and this issue deserves that because it's that important.
Yeah, I fully agree, and I think it's exactly the right time because there's been a few good films on this, but nothing current and, you know, that can focus everyone's energy on to raise attention and awareness of what's actually going in our food and who's controlling it. So it's very, very important.
Yeah, it's intimidating, you know, making a film where people say, oh, yeah, I've seen a film on GMOs or genetically modified food, and, you know, people might think, like, hey, there's already some films out there on this. Why would you need to make another one? But for me, I couldn't help myself because when I saw the article from Haiti and what the peasant movement of Papai did in marching in the streets, it was so inspirational. And nothing has changed. And so the story needs to be told again from a different perspective, and hopefully it will inspire and awaken a whole different audience and a different generation. And yeah, so many things right now are happening around this issue that I think it warrants another film being made.
Yeah, we need to get something to wake the Americans up and start revolting. Revolution.
Please.
Yeah. I don't know if it's possible.
It's in our blood, you know? I mean, we've done it in the past, you know, to get you damn Brits out of here. I mean, jeez.
Yeah, that's true. But, yeah, not as, I was going to say, not all of you are as fit as you used to be.
Yeah, it's hard to do that when, like, half of us are obese, half has ADD. And we're all drugged up on everything. It's kind of hard.
Exactly, yeah. But, yeah, and that's why it's fantastic to see other people stand up and fight this, and like they're doing in Haiti, especially after all the devastation there. And so I think you're right in choosing this as a really quite a unique and hope-bringing sort of message. I think it's incredible, yeah.
Yeah, I hope so. Now we just need a title for this film. So anybody has a good idea for a title? I've got a few, but, you know, my friends and people working with me on this keep shooting them down. So so well, we're still looking for that amazing title.
Well, I hope you'll get that, and I hope you get the money you're after and the help you need. And, yeah, really look forward to maybe speaking to you in the future and seeing how you get on. And can't wait to see the film when it comes out.
Thanks for having me on, Richard.
Oh, no, it's great talking to you, Jeremy. And take care. Enjoy the rest of your day.
All right, you too. Well, yeah. Your day is over.
Yes, that's true. Well, take care. Cheers, Jeremy.
Right. Bye.
Yeah, bye.
Like to know.
Public awareness is the key.
Yeah, it should be labeled.
They should be labeled because everybody needs a choice in life.
Yet the truth which will refresh my broken.
We should know what we're eating.
It should be labeled so people know.
Do you have a right to know what we're eating?
Wouldn't you want to know what you eat?
See where those endorphins through my tears and know my coldest.
I made you some GMO goggles.
So many thanks to Jeremy Seifert there. Fascinating project he's working on. And today is Sunday the 7th of August, and I've just seen that the GMO film project on Kickstarter has just reached its target, it's over its target, and Laurie David has agreed to match every dollar above their $25,000 target. So, help support them, and look forward to watching the film. Now, any final thoughts on that, Patrick?
For sure, Rich. My first thought and most compelling
idea I got in the head right now is that Patrick is not here for the moment.
Yes, good point. And who are you?
Oh, hi. Nice to meet you. My name is Andres. How are you, Rich?
I'm very good, thanks.
I just sneaked into the show because I noticed that Patrick left his chair empty for a while, so I just thought maybe I'll drop in a few comments in there, if you allow me to.
Yeah, you're more than welcome. And yeah, have you got any thoughts on the topics that we covered?
Yeah, quite a few. First of all, I think it's quite encouraging that people take the initiative of saying something about this, something which worries me because of the fact that we have not enough information about what GMO foods are, you know. They haven't done proper testing. They don't know what it's going to lead to, if it actually has any health issues concerning everyone else, or how it actually affects, you know, the environment. To give you an idea where my concerns come from, last time I was at university, I met this girl who was doing a PhD on GMO foods. She was doing the PhD not from the science point of view, but from the point of view of political economy. But still, she had quite a bit of knowledge on the subject, much more than I did, for sure. So me being a curious guy, I approached her and I asked her what GMO foods were. Because I was under the impression that GMO foods were just like a fancy term to describe the process of selection of, you know, best types of plants and animals, the ones that were strongest or better suited for whichever purpose, and just keep on breeding those as opposed to others, so that you'll have in the end, you know, better crops or whatever. More or less in the same way that a person who breeds dogs will choose the best dogs to mate with other dogs so that he can get a better and better type of dog. And I didn't see anything wrong with that, you know. So I asked her what GMO foods were, if they really were tampering with the actual genetic code of organisms. And the way she explained it to me, and mind you, I'm not a biologist nor a geneticist, and neither was she, but the way she explained it to me was that in a laboratory, they would manage to isolate the piece of the genetic material of a plant which would be, say, more resistant to cold, and then they would put that in a little gun and shoot this genetic material into the DNA of corn, for example, therefore making corn also more resistant to cold. But that actually frightened me a lot, you know, because we know little about how the DNA works. It's a code, of course, so to make an analogy, it's as if you have the computer code for a computer, a very sophisticated software, and you didn't know exactly how it worked, but you knew that a little command would make you know, the computer run in a certain way that you wanted to, so you just inserted that command randomly in the middle of the software and expect the computer to do what you wanted to. Now, well, that sounds quite counterintuitive with me, because you don't know how you are messing up with the whole thing, you know? So that sort of worried me. It's the kind of thing, you know, the kind of attitude of human beings who create something without the knowledge of what's going to happen in the future. Like, you know, the guy who first created the gasoline combustion for cars, Henry Ford, was this the guy perhaps? Well, I'm not sure, but this guy probably didn't imagine that at some point he would have a pollution problem. So it's the same thing with GMO foods. They are messing with nature in a way that they do not understand. And the reason they are doing it is greed, as far as I can see, because as long as you do your own tampering of DNA, then you can patent it, and then it's yours by law, and then you can charge for it, which is exactly what Monsanto is doing. Anyway, Rich, just a little bit of...
Yeah, no, that's really, really good. I love the way you explained it there. And yes, it is a very disturbing topic, and I'm sure it's one that we're going to return back to. And very interesting to keep an eye out on what the legislation are and the impact of films such as Jeremy Seifert's and the impact that has in raising awareness, and just how people wake up to the fact that really they need to take responsibility for what goes into them. And we can't always be sure that we're eating the healthiest foods that we can, even if it says it is, because of the labelling. So, thank you very much, Andres.
You're welcome, Rich. Thanks for letting me sneak into your show.
You're more than welcome. Now, I'd like to thank the music was provided by David Rovix and Mike Adams from Natural News. I'd like to thank Doug Eason in Bath. And please join us on the 28th of August for our next podcast. Be sure to tune in.
I will.
Cheers. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Everyman Radio.